Thank you. Amen. Good evening. Welcome to our Sunday night service at Timberlake Baptist Church. If you've been enjoying the announcements, you've been enjoying the music that Miss Angie's been playing. We graciously appreciate her playing. And most of all, that last song, so Up From the Grave He Arose. And we thank God for that, He Arose, because that gives us hope in this terrible time that's going on. That as long as we got Christ, we got hope. Let's look at our precept for this week, which comes from Proverbs chapter 24. In verse 3, it says, through wisdom, which is a house, build it, and by understanding, it is established. We build our house on the rock of Christ, everything we do, and we need to gain his understanding. And tonight, as we dig into his word, we're going to look for understanding that we have something better tonight. With that, we're going to open with a word of prayer. And as I encouraged you last week, if you got any prayer requests, please put them online or send them to us. We definitely want to be praying for them. Let's open in a word of prayer. Dear precious Father, we just thank you for your many blessings, Lord. We just thank you for the season, Lord. Lord, we know that if it wasn't for Easter, there would be no hope. There would be no victory. Nothing would even matter. But Lord, you brought us hope, Lord, by just sending your only Son, who went through an awful sacrifice on our behalf. Not because he just had to, but because he wanted to. Lord, we just thank you for every blood that was shed on our behalf. Lord, I just thank you for that hope, for that resurrection. Lord, I just thank you for that promise of heaven. Lord, tonight we ask you to be with the service. Lord, just the music, the videos. Lord, we ask you just be with everything. Be with the pastor, anoint him on high, Lord. Just give him a fresh anointing. Lord, as he preaches your message tonight, Lord. And Lord, as this goes out over the airways, Lord, I pray for everyone that hears this tonight, Lord, that this changes their life. Encourage them to keep going. Or whether they're carrying a burden, it'll help them learn to, Lord, just lean on you more. But most of all, Lord, as one that's listening that don't know you, that tonight, Lord, that they'll get their hope by giving their life to you. Lord, we got many, Lord, that are sick. Lord, we ask you to reach down and touch them. Lord, we ask you to be with the family of Betty Gentry, and that family also be with the family of Nancy Loftus. Lord, we ask you to continue to be with Audrey Hoskins. I'll be with Carol Tickle and her back and medicine. Lord, we ask you to be with Vicki Burnett. She has two stents being put in this week. Just reach down and touch her and be with the doctors. Lord, be with Edna Earl Shelton as her hand heals from a cut. Lord, we pray now, Lord, for Amy Grafton, Lord, that she's in UVA, Lord, that I ask you to just reach down and touch her body, be with the nurses and doctors. Lord, just work a miracle on her behalf, Lord. Lord, I ask you to be with Linda Durham with her back and injections, and Lord, and also be with Brother Jamie and his loss of appetite. Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity, Lord, just to pray. Lord, just knowing that you're going to meet each and every one of our needs, Lord. Lord, I pray for this virus, Lord, to quickly go. Lord, I ask you to be with the families that are affected by it. Be with all those that are having to deal and treat those around them. Lord, I just thank you for what you're going to do. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that we're still seeing your blessings flow despite what's going on in this world. Lord, we just thank you for what you're going to do. It's in your precious and holy name I pray. Amen. Just like this morning, if you missed it, but now we're going to show a video for some of the wonderful things about what Easter means to people.
Good.
What Jesus means to me, Jesus' love is a love that cannot be bought by anything in this world. That's what Jesus means to me.
To me, Jesus' love is beautiful. It's as beautiful as this flower right here. But unlike this flower, which will wilt and die, Jesus' love never will. Jesus' love has stayed with me when I didn't deserve it, and let's face it, I never have. But when I was being the worst me I could be, Jesus loved me.
This Easter, Jesus means the world to me. Like, given that this wasn't like your normal Easter season, this has really just been an incredible time to just sit back and just reflect on all the good things that Jesus has done in our life, because he's just such a forgiving and like understanding God. I just thank him for everything that he's done, like saving me, just giving me the life that I need to live, and just being so good and never forgetting that we actually do need him in our lives.
Hello, this is Ricky Toller, and what does Jesus mean to me? It means my salvation. It means my brother. It means love. He's very special to me, and I depend on him. And that's what Jesus means to me. Amen.
This Easter, Jesus truly means to me that he really is my provider. He has provided me good health to be able to go out and still work. He's provided me happiness and leads me through these tough times. And he's provided me hope. And I know that it may be pain through the night, but joy comes in the morning. Hope you guys have a happy Easter. God bless.
Hey, everybody. Jesus means a lot to me, but this Easter he means undeserved forgiveness. Remember that he died on the cross for you and for me. Happy Easter!
What Jesus means to me this Easter is that he provided us with hope and truth, that he is the true risen Savior. And I'm thankful for his salvation and all that he's done for me and my family and my friends. Happy Easter, everybody.
Amen. We should always spend time thinking about what God means to us each and every day. I thank you for Easter, and I hope all of you have had a wonderful Easter. It has been a different one, but it's been a time that we can reflect on his goodness and know that we still have hope in him. A couple announcements tonight. The pastor will be preaching the wonder of the resurrection. So if you got your word of God, would you can go ahead now and turn to Matthew 22, verse 23, and get ready. Also, don't forget, the books are available for ask, seek, and knock. Go to the website, get it. It's a wonderful Bible study that you can go through this month. Also, if you've been missing Sunday school at 9:45, you're missing a blessing. As we're looking at the miracle-working power of God. Also, I just want to read today's prayer, this week's prayer for today. The words are very powerful. Lord, help me to share my joy. We need to remember joy doesn't just come from the things around us. It comes from God. And hope. So share my joy and hope of the resurrection. May others find Christ. We do everything we do. Keep them all week. Review it. Keep going. A lot of things are coming. We're still pressing on for Christ. And at this time, we're going to watch another video. Be from the Perry Sisters, Resurrection Morn.
Forward to me at the ending of that day. They watched as Joseph rolled the stone, then they sadly walked away. But suddenly, within their broken hearts, echoed the words they heard him say, "Don't weep for me, I'll live again on resurrection morn. Resurrection morn, he rose to set the captive free. Resurrection morn, was gone. Mary cried and said, finally. He sat with them and broke the bread that their eyes were made to see. As they watched him taken from their sight, behold, two men robed in white said, Elias said, he'll come again on the resurrection. Resurrection, Lord, he arose to set the captive free. Resurrection, Lord, Jesus won the victory. Mary cried and said, my Savior lives on resurrection, Lord. Resurrection, Lord.
Oh, aren't you glad for Jesus?
Amen. Thank God for the resurrection morning. His brother Ken's coming for a few announcements.
Thank you, Brother Tony. Once again, as we come to our offering time that we normally have, I want to thank everyone who's been continually giving their tithes and offerings. I do actually have an official, straight out of book update on our building fund. So that's really good. We're getting better with this. We actually were able to get last week $1,360 to our building fund. That is a wonderful big amen to that, because if we keep at that pace, we're going to be out there in Blair's probably before the coronavirus leaves. I hope so. So anyway, keep in mind that tithes are always available through mail through Timberlake Baptist Church, P.O. Box 10004, that's 30s, Danville, Virginia, 24543. Also, we have it on strengthnumber4today.com, where you can send your tithes and offerings in through your credit cards or debit cards, whichever plastic that you choose from. So all those are available to you at that time. I'm going to go ahead and pray for the offering, and then we're going to be having a song called Something Happening by the Hoppers. So let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for everything you do for us. We're thankful, God, for every blessing you bestow upon us. We're thankful so much for the wonderful promise of the resurrection and for the promise to know that if everyone who's called upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We ask, Lord, that many people during this unique time that we're in would call upon and ask Christ to be their Savior. And we ask, Lord, that once we get back here, congregating here once again, Lord, may we just shout praises to your honor for everything that is done. We ask you to bless this offering, bless our time in your house. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Something's happening in Bethlehem. From a stable, a lovely light grows within.
Is that a baby crying? There's excitement in the wind.
Something's happening in Bethlehem.
He was born in Bethlehem. Shepherds declared that angels announced his birth. Now that caused a stir. When men came asking, where is he that is born King of the Jews? We've seen his star and have come to worship him. Herod was filled with wrath. The babe is now a man teaching a new doctrine with compassion and authority. The crowds are following him. The chief priests and elders are outraged. There's a mob outside of Pilate's home today.
Something's happening in Pilate's hall. On the porch, Pilate pleads with an angry mob. In this man called Jesus, I can find no fault. Something's happening in Pilate's hall.
I watched as his beaten, disfigured body fell beneath the load of the cross. His mother ran to him, and the soldiers pushed her away. I heard the hammer fall. I knew the nails had been driven, and he was on the cross. The scoffers kept chanting. I heard him speak words of forgiveness. There was an earthquake and a darkness over the earth. Then I heard a cry from the cross. It is finished. We watched him die, but somewhere deep within my being, I know this is not over.
Something's happening at Joseph's grave, where Jesus of Nazareth has laid 3 days. Very early in the morning, how the earth begins to quake. Something's happening at Joseph's grave. Come and smell the fragrance.
And there's still something happening today because he's still alive and he's still well. Take your Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 22 and verse 23. I want to preach to you a message tonight entitled The Wonder of the Resurrection. We know it happened. We talked about that this morning. But tonight we want to talk about the wonder of the resurrection. There's several things I want to share with you. First of all, tonight, in Matthew chapter 22 and verse 23, we see the doubting the reality of the resurrection. People have always doubted that it really happened. They even doubted in that day in the reality of the resurrection. It says, the same day came to him Sadducees, which say there is no resurrection, and ask him. These were the forerunners of our modern day Jehovah's Witnesses. They don't believe in a resurrection. The Jehovah's Witnesses don't believe, but 144,000 people are going to heaven. That's a sad belief. It's a wrong belief. It's a twisted belief. And these Sadducees, they were called Sadducees because they didn't believe in the resurrection. They were sad, you see. Y'all will get that tomorrow afternoon. Y'all will laugh loud tomorrow afternoon on that one. They were religious fatalists, which absolutely makes no sense. Why have religion if there's no hope in it? There's no hope of eternal life. Why live for God? God's saving us from sin and saving us unto heaven. If there's not a chance of eternal life and the hope of redemption after this life, why have faith at all? These Sadducees were pessimistic skeptics, cynics, and doubters, and they were doubters to the nth degree. The world's still full of them today, people doubting Jesus Christ, the mealy-mouthed mully-grubs of the world, doubting the reality of the resurrection. People of faith should be people of hope and excitement and joy of the pure promises of God. The two songs you heard by the Perry Sisters and the Hoppers, they were joyful songs and rejoicing in the resurrection of Christ, that he's alive and well and living today. And we're going to live forever because of that. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8 says, I will therefore with the men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. We ought to be praising God and rejoicing that he's risen and he's coming again. And that's the joy that we have. We should be living in the wonder of it all, not in the bitterness of cynicism that the world would have you live in. So, doubting in reality the resurrection. Number two, the coming of another resurrection. There's coming another day when the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then those that are alive and remain will be caught up with the Lord in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. That's what the Bible teaches us. But here in John chapter 5, verse 28, let's read this together. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that were in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth, and they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil to the resurrection of damnation. These are the very words of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And he promised there would be a resurrection. Everybody's going to be resurrected. But somebody's going to be resurrected to life who's trusted Christ. And those who've doubted him will be resurrected to death and hell for all of eternity. There are four prophesied resurrections in the Bible. And two have already been and are daily being fulfilled. And two are soon to come to pass. First of all, there's the resurrection of the Savior. Jesus rose from the dead on the third day.
Then there's the resurrection of the soul. When man gets saved, he's redeemed from sin, and his life is redeemed in Christ. The Holy Spirit comes to live within. And so there's a resurrection of our soul, not our flesh. That'll come later, but right now the resurrection of the soul. Then see the resurrection of saints at the rapture for the church and the Old Testament saints before the new heaven and the new earth. Then all that will take place. And so those resurrections are to come. But there's also the one I want to talk about for a minute, the resurrection of sinners. Those who are lost at the great white throne judgment of God. There will be a resurrection that day, a sad one, that will resurrect their physical bodies and meet together again with their souls, which are in hell, to be determined to spend eternity and sentenced to hell for all of eternity. Look at Daniel chapter 12, verse 1. At that time shall Michael stand up, and the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble such as was never since the nation was a nation. There was a nation, even to the same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, and every one of them that is found written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Thank God for those who are soul winners, trying to put the brands out of the fire and bring people to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Because if they're not saved, they'll be raised to everlasting contempt. They'll be sentenced to hell. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, verse 15, if your name's not found written in the Lamb's book of life, you'll be cast in the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are. And there you will reign with Satan forever in a place called hell. So, folks, those are the four resurrections. But they're doubting today, just as they did in New Testament times. They were doubting the resurrection. And there's coming other resurrections, the four we just talked about. Now let's look at number three. Believing is hope of the resurrection. Believing is hope of the resurrection. I want to show you John chapter 11, verse 22. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Verse 23. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last days. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead physically, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? It is important what you believe about the resurrection. It is important that you believe in the resurrection of the past. And also you believe in the resurrection of the future. Jesus was about to raise Lazarus from the dead here in this passage of Scripture. And Jesus was going to use this opportunity to teach them a truth about the resurrection and about everlasting life. Jesus was trying to make it clear to Martha that there's not just hope in the end for this thing, but there's hope in life right now. The resurrection is just not about the end of your life, it's about your whole life. Having hope in a living Savior. Jesus was a resurrection before he died on the cross. He was giving life before he ever died on that cross and gave his life. I ask you the same question Jesus asked Martha. Believest thou this? Do you believe that he's the giver of life before life, during life, and after life is over? I do. I believe he's the life giver all the way around. Are you a pessimistic Sadducee? Or are you a hopeful child of God? Hoping in a living Savior who's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I can see his hand of mercy. I can hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. I'm glad he's alive today. Believing is not only living forever, it's living right now. Living a life of hope and joy. The Bible says in Luke chapter 4, verse 21, and he began to say unto them, this day is scripture fulfilled in your ears. Folks, I love to see God doing things now, not just later. Everybody's always worried about prophecy, what's about to happen. Man, I want to see what's happening right now. I want to see lives changed, prayers answered, souls saved. I want to see God do miracles now, in this life, while we're living. See God do some wonderful, blessed things. Psalms 118:23 says, this, and I hope you can say this in your life today, it's something that's happened in your life. This is the Lord's doing. It's marvelous in our eyes, our physical eyes, seeing in this life. Verse 24, this is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice today in this life and be glad in this life in it. Save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. Folks, we ought to want to see God doing great things now. Blessing our lives today. I hope he blesses me with getting rid of this frog. Say amen. But he wants to bless us this hour. He wants us to be blessed this day. Prosperity in this life, seeing God reach through our life and touch the lives of other people, the lost who need to be saved, the hurting who need to be encouraged, those who are disillusioned to be brought back into faith and trust in God. Believing in the resurrection right now means that God is now doing things, not just after we die, not just in the darkest hours of our gloom, but in every day that we live, believing there's more to come, there's more to be done. And the verse is very clear here. It says, if by any means, blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. That means when people come in the name of the Lord, he brings a blessing. Thank you, Katie. Katie's going to give me some water. This will be over in a minute. But when we come in the name of the Lord, we're coming to do his work. Him through me and you. Him through us. And if he works through me and you, then he can bless their lives. We're just a vessel. We need to be a vessel of honor. And then they can say they've been blessed by the people of the house of the Lord. Been blessed by the people who serve the Lord with all their hope and might. Every day we live, we ought to live so that people see Jesus in us. See him alive. That's the only way they're ever going to see him. You're the only Bible some people are ever going to read. You're the only miracle some people are ever going to see. And we've got to live our lives so that God can bless other people through us and they can see that Jesus is alive and well, that he's able to do much today, just as he did in that day. The reason we're not seeing as much today is because people aren't believing enough. Less faith, less miracles. More faith, more miracles. And we have got to start believing more. And we need to start praising him more. Let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. Thank you, Miss Katie. Let's wash that frog away. Say amen. Number four, knowing the power of the resurrection. You're not going to know the power of the resurrection until you start believing more in your life. More than just to save your soul out of hell, but to bless your life here and make your life a blessing to others. We have got to believe he's alive and still working. Alive and working through me and you. Philippians chapter 3, verse 9. And be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, just doing what's right. If all we ever have is what we do right and what we do wrong, there's no miracle in that. It says, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of faith by God, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, or surrender to his the Lord's will, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Folks, we have got to believe there's more to life than just crossing our T's and dotting our I's. Yes, we've got to do that. Yes, we've got to live like God says live, but we've also got to do like God says do. We got to go like God says go. And we've got to share the gospel and be a blessing, encourage the brethren, and win the lost. It's got to be more than this life just sitting around looking at each other, judging each other. No, we've got to see the resurrection of God, the power of God working in and amongst the people of God. I still can't get over how the other day, when Wendy and I was at Western Sizzling, a little boy come tug my coat. He saw me all the way across the room. And he comes and said, "Preacher, pray for my granddaddy." His grandmother told me that he was in the hospital on a ventilator. Didn't look good. The other day I had somebody call me and tell me, "You know that guy's gone home?" Let me tell you something. It was no accident he got well. It was no accident he got to go home. God's people prayed for that man. And God touched him and God healed him and sent him home. That's the miracle working power of the resurrection today. Not 150 years ago, not 1,000 years ago, not 2,000 years ago. That's today. God working miracles and blessing through our lives. The power of life is not in us. It's in him working through me and you. If we want a resurrected life now and a wondrous time of journey here, we better live for Christ and walk with him and bless him. Hold his hand. Do his bidding. Be obedient, child. Make him happy so he can reach through you and touch somebody else's life and be a blessing in somebody else's life. I did something this week I've never done in my life. I did a vow renewal over the telephone. Never done such a thing before, but there was a couple that I married 30 years ago. That I married them, and they were having the 30th wedding anniversary. They were supposed to have a party and couldn't do it. So he said, "Would you call my wife on our wedding anniversary and renew our vows over the phone?" They live in South Carolina. So I did. And when I answered the phone, I said, "Hello." She said, "Hello." I said, "Do you know who this is?" And she said, "Some off-the-wall person." I said, "No, this is the preacher that married you 30 years ago. Well, she squealed a little bit and said she was so glad to hear my voice. And she said, "I was just doing my devotions this morning, and I remembered a story you told 30 years ago about the reality of hell. That blessed my heart that she remembered something I said 30 years ago, not just a wedding vows, but something else I said. 30 years ago, I made an impression that lasted 30 years, not that I made, but that I allowed God to make through me while I was teaching and preaching the Word of God." Folks, I'm telling you, impact is important to God. And you can't make any impact on your own. You have to have the help of the Holy Spirit of God to make an impact on your family, your friends, your neighbors, and the community you live in. God can take our useless dead lives and resurrect them into effective, productive, and constructive lives. I know a fellow who's a deacon back in my home church. Before he got saved, he was a town drunk. Matter of fact, the night he got saved, he had been drinking. And he wouldn't answer the door. My brother Earl kept knocking, and he finally got in. And he couldn't run from God anymore. Got saved, never drank another drop in his life. Been teaching Sunday school to little kids ever since. I believe in the resurrecting power of God. He can take a drunk and turn him into a Sunday school teacher and change the lives of the course of children over the last 35, 40 years. That's the God I serve. That's the resurrected Lord I serve. And he can take a troubled and destroyed life, and he can make it whole, he can make it new, and he can bless it with the power of the Holy Ghost. Romans 3:22. Katie, thank you for this word. I think I'm going to preach all night long now. Romans chapter 3, verse 22. "Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe." That believe, we have to believe. "For there's no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely through his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. This is available to everybody. Not just the preacher, not just the Sunday school teacher, but everybody that names the name of Jesus Christ. This is available to them. We become new. Old things have passed away. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Resurrection. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. That means we've got the ministry of bringing God and people together. That's all the church is about. It's about bringing God and man back together and bringing them together and finding redemption, finding a new life in Christ, finding a powerful life in Christ, not wasting the life that you've lived. I didn't used to think about dying, but I'm 55 years old now, double nickel, and I think about it now. I think about the shortening. You know, I had a fellow call me this afternoon, a friend of mine, made me promise I'd preach his funeral. I said, well, that's 30, 40 years off, and I hope it is 30, 40 years off. But when you get older, you start thinking, what have I done with my life? What have I done with the new life Christ gave me? Old things pass away, behold, all things become new. Have I made a difference? Have I made a mark for Christ? Or we can make a mark for ourselves, but it doesn't last very long. It's amazing how after you die, everybody forgets you. Everybody forgets you. But if you make an impact, nobody ever forgets you. If you make an impact for Christ, your impact could be eternal, forever. Folks, we need to realize knowing the power of the resurrection comes because we believe. We believe every day, not just to save you one time 30 years ago or 20 years ago or 10 days ago, whenever you got saved, but a faith that carries on through your life so that other people find faith out of your new walk with Christ. Folks, we need to make sure that we know the power of the resurrection, not just because we're saved, but because we help other people get saved and help other lives change, make an impact. Number five, empowering is from faith in the resurrection. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience of the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible that doesn't rot or fade away, undefiled, that fadeth away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. We are to set ourselves apart for the Lord. We're to do that through obedience to the Word of God, by faith in His Word, and hope of His help. We have faith because of a resurrected living Savior. We have much to look forward to, knowing that the Lord's alive and He's able to resurrect the dead, and if we have to go through the grave, He'll still resurrect us one day. Nothing should ever erode or rot in a life of hope. Think about that. In a life of hope, nothing should ever erode. We shouldn't be battling discouragement. We shouldn't be battling depression. Why? Because we got hope. We got to stop looking at circumstances, and we got to start looking at the Word of God. We've got to start believing Him at His Word, exercising our faith, and trusting Him. How do you know, preacher, if you exercise in His faith? If you exercise in faith, you don't have the sickness of worry. You don't have the sickness of fretting. You've got the wellness to go out and be encouraging to others, trying to save the lost and bring them to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Faith in God makes it impossible for our hopes and dreams to fade away. We're never hopeless. There's always hope if we'll trust Him. There's always hope if we obey Him. Even when things aren't good, God still loves us. You heard that in the testimony just a few minutes ago. And so don't get hopeless and think there's no hope for you. You've made a mistake or you've messed up. I'm glad God has 1 John 1:9 in the Bible. We confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Folks, there's hope no matter what happens. Whether something bad happens we didn't cause, or whether we slip up and make a mistake and ruin our lives, he'll still forgive you. He'll still restore you. Faith makes it impossible for our dreams and hopes to fade away. Why? Because we're kept by the very same power that Jesus had over death and he rose from the grave, that no other man in all of history has ever conquered. No one's ever conquered the grave but Jesus Christ. So if he can conquer the grave for me and you, all the rest of our problems are just small potatoes, nothing serious. All things work together for good to them that love God and those who are called according to his purpose. Number six, we ought to be living because of the resurrection. We ought to be living it up. We ought to be living it up for the Lord. Romans 6:5, for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we should also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. And henceforth we should not serve, look at that word carefully, the word sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. We shouldn't be living in sin. We should be living in service. That's the important point. This verse does not have to control you. You let it control you. It's your choice. We've got to choose not to let sin overcome us. Thank God, because Christ, now your man is dead. Christ is alive and well. Must keep him by faith and obedience to God's words. The old drunk is not on the riverside anymore. Brother Kyle Baldwin used to sing all the time that song, "The Old Man Is Dead." Kyle used to be, he wouldn't let you call him an alcoholic. He had to call him a drunk because he said that's what they were. They're just drunks. He said, before the old man died, I was a drunk. I was laying under bridges. I was drunk all the time. But when the old man died, I didn't want to drink alcohol anymore. I didn't want to live in the bar rooms anymore. He said, I want to live for Jesus. And his ministry was known as singing for Jesus, because that's where Kyle Baldwin is still to this day. He's singing for Jesus because the old man's dead. And the new man is living and serving God. Sin is defeated. And if we live by faith and not by sight, eyes on God and his word, not the things of this life and the problems and the pleasures that we have. Don't let pleasures deter you. Don't let problems disillusion you. Trust in God. Serve Christ every day and not your flesh. For we are free to serve God by the power of the Holy Ghost. We don't have to do bad things anymore. We can do good things. We don't have to live on the wrong side of the road anymore. We can live on the right side of the road and do things that honor God, because the old man is dead and our life is free, and we're free to live a blessed and happy life. Separation from God is abolished. Death has no power of us any longer, and we're able to serve Christ as we're filled with the Holy Ghost. Then number seven, witnessing of the resurrection. Some people never witness because they really haven't experienced the resurrection. I'm here to tell you tonight, if you've witnessed the resurrection of Christ, you will never be the same. You won't have anything else to talk about. You won't have anything else to shout about. You won't have anything else to deter you, because you'll know there's a God that makes a difference in your life. Look at Acts 4:31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God. For our charismatic friends, let me make sure you understand, they didn't say in tongues either. He said, the word of God, witnessing of the gospel with boldness. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of these things which was he possessed was his own. But he that had all, they had all things in common. Verse 33. And with, look at those two words, great power gave the apostles, what is that word? Witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Great strength, great power, great overcoming power. Tonight, some of you need some overcoming power. There are things in your life that are holding you back from being all you can be for God. And the Holy Spirit can get you over yourself. He can get you over your sin. He can get you over your rebellion and your selfishness. If you'll just surrender to Him and say, I want to live the resurrected life. I don't want to live the old dead, rotten life with all its problems and pressures and heartaches. I want to live a life of joy and a life of productivity. If we'll all live a prayerful life of faith, the world will shake around us by the power of God, not because of us, but because of who we represent. The Holy Spirit will lead, guide, and direct, protect, and bless our life every day and every effort. If we'll surrender to the Holy Spirit and live for Him, we'll be faithful and fruitful witnesses, and the message of gospel will be shared everywhere we go. We'll be united in the efforts and purposes of Christ and His work. We'll have courage and confidence in all because of Christ's holy boldness. God will enrich our lives with His resurrection power. There'll be nothing dead in our lives. Some of y'all might have got a little scared by the videos I've been showing today. You see some people throwing their hands up. You see some people saying, glory to God, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Don't let it scare you. That's how you ought to be acting. That's how you ought to be feeling. Happy. Happy about the resurrection. Happy about something's happening. Happy about great things are going on. Not nervous Nelly and Henny Penny, the sky's falling in. We ought to be excited. Hey, yeah, it may be the last days. These may be signs of the shortening of time, but that don't hurt me and you. We're going to heaven. We ought to be wanting to take everybody with us we can. And you can't take anybody with you if you're shaking like one of these little dogs that has the nervous Nellies. You can't win people to the Lord shaking and being fearful and crying and belly aching and feeling sorry for yourself. You got to live in the resurrection power and be excited and happy. God's sick of these dead churches. I know I am. I'm tired of coming to church, people frowning at me with their arms crossed saying, bless me if you can. Oh, listen, we need a church full of people who are going to shout and praise God, say amen, hallelujah, preach it, preacher, and glorify God and be excited. Hey, if you want to go to a dead church, just go visit a funeral home. Nothing's happening there. They're hauling them out one by one, putting them in the ground. I want to see life. I want to see people getting saved. I want to see things happening. Oh, listen, we need to be the purveyors of life. Live now, enjoy it, and then go to heaven and live forever. That's how we ought to be living. We all have the great strength and power of God in our lives that brings wondrous miracles, not scorning pessimism that destroys and defeats and discourages everybody in its path. It'll be evident to God, apparent to me and you, and obvious to everybody around us, if God's hand is upon our life and His anointing is upon us. Folks, God's power makes a powerful difference. And you're making an effect not to improve your ego or pad your ego or put the spotlight on you, but everywhere you go, the spotlight's on Jesus. And lifting Him up and glorifying His name for dying and giving His life, being buried and rising again. He'll make us powerful witnesses and effective soul winners in a dark and dry and thirsty land. I got a letter on the email yesterday from a fellow in South Carolina. He said, I want a soul winning manual. And send me one for his cousin. He said, he's 93 years old, he's still teaching Sunday school. I put them books in the mail yesterday, signed, sealed, and delivered. 93 years old, still teaching the Word of God, still wanting to win souls to Jesus. Hallelujah, I want to be a part of that. Say amen right there. We need to have some excitement back in our lives. We will be springs of living water in a dry and thirsty land if we'll just get in the Word of God and get under the spout where the glory comes out, and then we'll spread all over the place. Darkness cannot exist where there's light. Are you the light of the world? You hit that light switch, darkness is going away because light's coming on. But if you turn that light switch off, darkness is going to take over. We got to have the light of life emanating from us. Make your mind up that you're going to take the resurrection and enjoy it not just on Easter, but you're going to see the wondrous facts of the resurrection. We can't doubt it. It's a reality. There's coming another resurrection. We better be ready. The lost better get saved, and the saved better start serving. Believing in the hope of the resurrection, that Jesus is alive and well and working through us. Number four, knowing the power of the resurrection, seeing God reach through us and touch other people will build your faith, and it'll excite you for God. I'll tell you why people aren't excited. They're not doing anything for God. You do something for God, you'll get excited. Number five, empowering us by the resurrection. The Holy Spirit's there. Let's turn the Holy Spirit free. Let's live because of the resurrection, not in sin, but in service. And then finally, if you'll do all that, you'll be a witness of the resurrection. And other people will find out that Jesus is alive and able because you surrendered your body, a living sacrifice, whole and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a minute? If you're out there and you need Christ as your Lord and Savior today, the Bible's clear. In Romans chapter 3, verse 10, for all have sinned. There's none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:23 is for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We don't measure up to God. We need something to take us to that standard, remove our sin. Romans 5:8 said, but God commendeth the demonstrator, showed his love toward us. And that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. Then in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who rose from the dead. And then Romans 10:13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Preacher, I need to be saved right where you are. Bow your head, close your eyes, say, dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I desire to be saved. I ask you to take your death and your blood and pay my sin debt that I cannot pay. Lord, take your burial and bring me forgiveness and bury my past. And then, Lord, take your resurrection and write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life and promise me hope and guarantee me hope of eternal life in heaven. I accept Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as payment for my sins. I ask Jesus to save me right now. And I ask you, Lord, to help me serve you the rest of my days. In Jesus' name, amen. If you ask Christ to save you today, I'll tell you this, he did. You ask, and he did. And here today, I want you to take time to go to our website and our contact page, and I want you to let us know that Jesus Christ saved your soul. Let us send you some information on how to get started right in your new Christian walk with Christ. And let us partner with you and pray with you and help disciple you in your new walk with Jesus. Now let's talk to Christians for just a minute. Sometimes we forget how powerful the resurrection really is. How important the resurrection really is. We forget about that. And it causes us to let our lights dim. Let's remind ourselves the words they promised. Let's remind ourselves of the wondrous works of Christ. And let's make our mind up that we're going to live for him. And we're going to serve him. We're going to let our light shine. We're going to live in the power of the resurrection. We're not going to miss the blessings God has for us. Help us realize today the importance of the resurrection. Help us realize today we can still live a great life. We don't have to live in the doldrums. We can live in joy. God bless you to Wednesday night.
What a great message tonight on the power of the resurrection. Hope you enjoyed that message and both those messages today. I hope you've had an enjoyable Easter. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer now and close our service. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity we have to worship you today, Father. We thank you for the power of the resurrection, Father, and the fact that you died on the cross for us so many years ago, Father, that you'd save our unworthy souls, Father, and you would let us come and live with you in heaven. We just ask now, Father, that you be with us, be with those many people that have requests tonight, and please be with the family of Matt Smith, who's passed away. We pray, Father, you wrap your loving arms around him. You touch the family. and let them feel your power today, Father. Watch over us all. Bring us back together for our Wednesday night service this week, for our midweek prayer service. For I ask all these things in your name. Amen.